twice now. BMG not being here in the second weekend. So Sync Esports feeling pretty good about that, I'm sure. But Willow Keeper, a team that can compete, and a team that apparently may have some tricks up their sleeves that we can possibly see into this weekend. As Mini Maggot has been talking about. So Mini, we got a fun series ahead of us. I'm very intrigued to see especially what Tree's bringing to the table.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't want to go too much in sort of spoiled apart in terms of sort of tricks up their sleeve, but hopefully we'll see him in this series here. Already kind of a somewhat of a newish hero. I mean, we have seen Behemoth back on the scene like a few times, but not too, honestly. We haven't seen it too much, honestly. I mean, Zinc used to play it quite a bit when they used to run like Jungle Behemoth, but most likely I'm assuming we're going to see Jungle Behemoth here as well. Obviously pulling the initial creep wave and then from there farming the rest of the creep camps. And obviously they picked up the Kefilovent here as well and finish up in the first pick in Stage of Pharaoh. So not giving too much away from Zinc, which is kind of a good sort of strategy to make. So obviously there's not much that Zinc can really sort of gauge on what Tree are going to really do. Obviously they've got their Suicide with Pharaoh, obviously most likely their second support Behemoth. And then obviously Kefilovent put in the mix as well. So.
Well, yeah, so we're saying that, though, and I'm kind of curious about the trio of heroes that they go with here. I mean, you talk about the idea of pulling the creep wave for Behemoth. Again, we've seen that many times before, but where does that mean Kefilovent will end up? Because we already got a Pharaoh Suicide.
Who knows? I don't know. I mean, one thing I mean, we haven't seen in a long while, though, is like... Well, no, I don't think we've seen it at all. Obviously, we used to see, like, dual mids, but, I mean, we have never really seen dual mid Kefilovent, and it kind of can work, because, obviously, it has a lead stun, similar to Magnus. It's very, very tanky as well, so most likely it won't be able to sort of drop into any other sort of dual mid combo. But also, something that shouldn't really be understated is that his Hookem, obviously, it can... get your lane sort of creeps and sort of get the creep equilibrium at sort of level 2 rank Hookem. And although, you know, middle lane isn't, you know, the biggest thing about in terms of having lane control, but it can help in terms of sort of setting up ganks from any kind of rotation from a support. So yeah, a lot of his skill sets is definitely useful in terms of having to be used in a dual mid, but whether we'll see it here or not is another question.
That is the question, indeed. We have to wait to get answered here from Willowkeeper, of course. Yeah, speaking of Sync, obviously, you know, they got their hero in Swiftblade. KZ will most likely end up with that. They got a lot of comfort here. Swiftblade, Tempest, and Doctor Impulse here. I mean, all three of those heroes, they love to play, and they will play it very well. So, and that's at the same time, we're already a little scared almost for Willowkeeper. But, you know, Willowkeeper does have a lot of stun heavy already with their makeup. Again, the Behemoth definitely bringing that to the table, especially. Not a hero we see too often, but as you see those 10 games right there, he's actually 7-3 overall. I mean, this is a hero with some good potential. He's arguably one of the better initiators in the game with a skill set. You get in that portal key, and he's up there with the best of them, of course. So, that's definitely going to be the idea there. Root of Z, as you pointed out, most likely going to be ending up with him, perhaps as a secondary support more during the jungle pull. A lot of time being used here on this final ban from Willowkeeper. They finally go with the Empath ban, of course, a strong combo with the Swiftblade especially, and taking away that solid support option. That already with the Engineer ban and even the Pyromancer. So Insania heavy bans here coming out. And Insania, of course, the new captain even for Sync, at least as far as the drafting goes.
Glacius is still on the board. Whether we're going to see Tree pick up as a response, we'll have to see. But obviously, Torture is on the board as well. But, man, look at that ban. Look at that ban.
Are you serious?
Oh, man.
Flint Beastwood band? Are you serious? I mean, we
man,
talked about
that a lot.
They ran it against... Who do they run it against? They ran it against Shrek is Love, I believe?
Yes.
I mean, so that's one of those... Again, nothing against Shrek is Love, but... Is Sync really that scared?
People like weren't very scared of like Geomancer's sort of on Boxy, and then we started seeing bans on that because it started owning. So why not, man? Like if Tree feel comfortable with playing it, then why not ban it? And I mean, I do like the ban honestly coming from Insania. Like they obviously need to pick up a carry, and Flint Beastwood is one of the heroes they've been playing a lot. Obviously, this does leave actually Silhouette on the board, so. Most likely a follow-up Silhouette pick here from Tree, but we'll have to see.
All right, yeah. Well, look here. Silhouette could be... Oh, definitely not a Sync side, I guess. Yeah, they already have the Doctor and even the Swiftblade, so... Yeah, definitely Tree would be the ones to pick it up if that, but... Sync could have put some time into this one. Again, they had a lot of extra time saved up, so might as well use it. Make sure they're comfortable with whatever pick that may be. But yeah, I'm still shocked about that Flint Beastwood band, man. Torture, though, coming out with the pick. There's a Miraxis. Interesting there. Not usually your go-to hero as far as your middle, you know, initiator and whatnot, but Sync making a point that they like it here. And I'm trying to look at what they're going up against and wonder why maybe that would be proved to be a good option for them. But, you know, his not his passive, but his Moraxes, his E ability is actually pretty good against tankier heroes in the sense it does more damage based on their life. So maybe that's some logic there. I don't know, but...
I mean, if they want another ranged carry, they could pick up Clanks as well.
Yeah, Clank. Well, no. Is Clank still banned, I believe?
No. We've seen it before. We've seen it like this cycle.
No, really? Did we?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe he was allowed then. Yeah, I could have sworn it. Yeah, because I know that they banned it because there was a bug that was found on him. That was going into cycle 4, I believe.
Oh.
And
okay.
Even though it might have been fixed, I still think they're keeping him banned for now, from my understanding. So, yeah.
Prince, you're saying him is banned, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Strange. But, either way, they pick up the Alonia, actually. An interesting hero, because I've seen them play this in scrims all the time, and they actually run it as a carry Alonia. So already, there's kind of a time limit here on Tree's sort of late game, because they don't have any really strong physical presence, because obviously they don't have like a conventional hard carry, but they do have incredible amounts of burst and magical damage, which can be very, very useful in terms of the mid game. Battlezar's going to be playing Alonia, obviously, so expect even a Staff of the Master, perhaps, on him. And Zing, obviously, follow up with Nymphora, actually. So, again, Nymphora, a hero that, I mean, we're saying that isn't really picked up too much as a first support, but picked up here, actually, though.
Well, you know, it's kind of interesting seeing it in that drafter role, because he's talked about it plenty of times, how he wants to play certain heroes, but Flinch just never really drafted it for him because he didn't want to try that new thing, or even as much as Insania was just like, oh my god, I swear it's going to work. I know Artesia is kind of one that he really wants to make work. And so, but with him being the drafter now... there's a huge DC here, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I kind of caught up to that too.
So all of Legion just started turning around and walking back to the base.
<It's> like,
I was like, that's DC.
Let's go back. All right, so. I'll pause here and I'm sure that'll be fine. But, to his point, going back to that, yeah, Nymphora, not necessarily your go to support hero, and maybe that Synchro, especially not known for picking it up. But hey, he's like, you know what? I'm the draft for now. I'm going to pick up Nymphora. And we can make it work here. They do have the Nymphora Doctor combination, as you were just talking about last series, even. So I will say this, though. I love seeing Alonia being played by Balthazar here. I mean, Alonia is one of these heroes. She's kind of one that we don't see often. We very rarely see, frankly, on the competitive scene. But when we have seen her, she's usually played as more of a secondary main support, even. And that always kind of makes me like, I know her potential is so much more than that. And if you give her that farming role, if you give her the short-laming kind of carry role, at least for the earlier game state, she can be very scary. Her damage potential is ridiculous when you combo her abilities and everything. So
a little bit awkward when they pick up Shrunken Heads, though, because then she's like, oh, crap.
I mean, this is a very early game team. There's no doubt in that.
Yeah. I mean, like, what does Tree have to offer outside of, like, Shrunken Heads? Like, when they pick up... When Zing pick up Shrunken Heads... What are they going to do? Like, there's nothing. You know, like, you got Pharaoh ulti. That's about it, really. Cthulhuphan auto attacks, and that's about it, really. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? There's just nothing that that really offers. So, obviously, Swiftblade has his Shrunken Head built in already. So, yeah, when Shrunken Head's being picked up from Tempest, Doctor, and Moraxis, even Swiftblade might jump in the bandwagon and pick up a Shrunken Head as well, even though he does have the Blade Frenzy. So, yeah. I mean, Tree, we do talk about it. They do this a lot all the time. Like, they really do. We don't draft a lot of physical presence heroes. They really do like to sort of have your bursty magic sort of damage dealers. And I guess they do find, you know, the ways to work it. Obviously, the last series we had, we talked about how much, you know, Nolson had all kind of magical damage, yet they were fighting against two Shrunken Heads, particularly from Dark Lady, and they still made it work. So, yeah. You know, pick up the Sheep Sticks, have that burst initiation. And obviously, it can still pan out, but... In theory, it's going to be hard for him once he gets into the mid to late game stages of the game.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. That's fair to bring up. So no doubt Willow Keeper is going to be about, we need to get shit done ASAP, is what that ultimately comes down to. So we're going to look at Behemoth here initially. Now, he doesn't pull the initial creep wave. He's actually blocking a little bit for Alonia right here, but he'll probably pull that second creep wave and look to farm with that, of course. So yeah, he lets Alonia get the initial start. And that makes sense there, but going to be taking the next one. What is this about? As a note, recent gaming beat Prime Icarus 2-1 in the winner bracket finals. Okay, so yeah, that means Reason Gaming does qualify for Diamond Cycle 6. Swiftplay bottom lane. He's in some trouble now. Fissure Stun is ready to go from Rude Disease. It's about finding the angle, though. And he's not actually going to use it in the end. You know, I like that, though, because they weren't going to get the kill, so it's all about why waste the mana, especially on Behemoth. He uses one Swiftblade Fissure, and it's like...
Yep, and Swiftblade had Health Potion as well, so if he pops the stun there, it's not going to be worth it. So definitely good play count from Root in that respect.
Now, he doesn't pull the next creep wave, though, so this is actually delaying him, however.
And at the same time, like, obviously, they're doing a tri-lane down there to sort of shut down the Swiftblade, which honestly isn't the worst of sort of scenarios, because obviously we've seen KZ on Swiftblade absolutely dominate time and time again. If they can lock him down, then that's fine, that's good and all. But at the same time, they're going to slowly lose out in terms of golden experience because of obviously the Tempest in the jungle. I was speaking to actually Keizu before this series, I think, sort of in earlier today, and he said Trio are a great team, but if they picked up jungle strategies, they'd be 10 times better. So, I don't know, just Trio, maybe they don't have a jungle player. I know Fuzen isn't too, doesn't really like the jungle of heroes and not that sort of comfortable on them, but I know it just feels like they're so adamant to try and make the secondary support role or meta work.
Yeah, I mean, so this does mean Cthulhu ends up here, and actually he's running into a little bit of trouble, but he tramples through and is going to be fine. And actually, look at that, nice little regen room going to be sitting there for him, so he'll gladly pick that up and go back to full life and full mana. That happens to be RNG, the Han Gods, on the side right there. So good for him. I was going to say, though, yeah, he's up top, though. Pharaoh's in the middle lane, but yeah, So, yes, Swiftblade is 12-0 with Sync Esports. When they get their hands on Swiftblade, especially, this is a team that doesn't lose much, but especially they don't lose with Swiftblade. So, it's almost like, this is really putting a lot, though, in saying, like, we're going to make sure Swiftblade gets nothing at the cost of our supports getting no levels and no farm whatsoever. I just don't know if that makes the most sense here.
But, yeah, I mean, it's almost like 3 minutes into the game and they're already like nearly 1,000 experience and nearly like 1,000 gold behind. And yeah, I mean, unless they have some good early roams onto sort of mid or top, then you know they're not really gonna get a lot of a golden experience if they're not really jungling. Like both of these supports are level one. Like Nymphora is level three. Yes, of course, you know Swiftblade is level one as well, but they're trading two for one. Yeah. Top lane, Fulifant is actually dropping quite low.
He has trample though. It's a matter of will he be able to use this correctly. Look at Nymphora, the positioning, the perfect positioning from Insania. Now he's got the Zeal stun. Great execution on his part. I mean, not much box he could have done there once he was starting to fall back, because that was just all great play by Insania more so, as far as the positioning goes. Even if he got hit by the stun, it could have still very likely been a kill. Pharaoh, in the meantime, Mummy Wall's come up. He's going to be fine. Look at Swiftblade. That's a lot of damage, man. Tormented Soul, maybe? It's level 2, but no, not going to be enough for a kill. That's going to get some low, however. So, yeah, I mean, mission is accomplished. They are locking down Swiftblade,
but
to be fair.
At the same time, that they're trading, you know, Swiftblade's farm for two of the supports from Tree. So they've got two level 1s just to trade level 1 on Keizu. In theory, it's just not worth it, because look at the golden experience lead. Like, it's only 4 minutes in, and yet they're behind like 1,000 gold and 1,000 experience almost.
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah, you know, they are obviously, like you said, doing the right thing in terms of striking down Swiftblade, but you still got Dr. Repulsor, Miraxis, Tempest, and Infora to worry about. So, you
know. I guess this is really Willowkeeper making a statement that they're all about the Alonia too, and we're going to really need to see the true power of Alonia when she gets free farm and what she can do early on in the game. Because that's 100% of them, all the strategies it's really accomplishing, is what it seems like in the end. And again, no doubt the lineup kind of speaks for that in the first place. So maybe that's where it does make some sense, what Tree's doing here, that it is all about the early game for them. So taking out Swiftblade, where he can shine somewhat in the early game of the Suicide, especially played by Keizu. Now they are going to give some farm to Behemoth here, it looks like. So a little bit of transition coming out as Alonia will go to the jungle. They plan all along. I mean, Alonia, now that she's level 5, her jungle presence, they got some sack camps. I mean, you look at that right there. She actually cleans it up pretty fast. She has a bottle here.
And this is actually one of the strategies they've been playing with a lot. So they get like a hero on the short lane, they run this tri lane, and then they swap over. There's one of the supports to actually farm it. And so normally we'll start seeing Alonia start farming the jungle, and they try and do this, try and maximize their golden experience. Actually, middle lane, Swiftblade's coming in on Pharaoh.
Middle lane though, yeah, Pharaoh is in trouble right here. Now he's going at a pretty good angle, and actually Swiftblade needs to be careful not to have the tower, especially with Alonia coming in. Miraxis also in a lot of trouble. She has absolute zero, but really not the best chance to use it there. So
she's she's gone sort of jungle build, so like she hasn't actually picked up the boots. If she has she has boots there, the Maraxxus is going to die. But yeah, just going back to what Tree do, this is kind of the strategy they've been playing with a lot. I've been watching them in the scrim. So they have like their hard carry like Balthazar. They get him like level 6, level 7, then he starts rotating into the jungle. It frees up another lane for a secondary support to actually, you know, get levels. In this case, it's going to be Behemoth. So obviously, he's going to work towards this sort of Ring of Sorcery and Portal Key. And it can work, obviously. But the only problem is, obviously, that they could have had this from the start. Have a jungler in the start, at the start, and then, you know, run their carry in the short line and keep him there, you know, entirely. But obviously, this is what Tree's, one of their sort of secret strategies, now, per se, has been running.
I got to stress this, though. One thing that's kind of screwing it over a little bit, and this is where RNG comes into play, sort of in jungle in general. You look at this middle camp right here in the Legion jungle. Double Wild Hunter had spawned. And that is not friendly for Alonia, who's going to the jungle. So that kind of screwed her in a sense. She would definitely be level 7 right now, and even obviously more farm on top of that. So, and that's one of those factors. I mean, you look at this, especially with this strategy being so all-in a sense of being the early game and kind of the strategy. So that hurts. That hurts a lot. I mean, I'm not going to say it's going to be a loss in the end because of that, but that is something that will definitely set them behind as far as what they're trying to accomplish here. Now, with all this said, I mean, Dr. Pulsar, he's, of course, having a great time on top of himself. Flynn Smasher doing his thing, 345 gold per minute. And, you know, that's showing in his farm. I'm sure maybe something like that icon we're going to see earlier on, expecting some fights to happen as soon as possible here. So some more stacks coming out. You see Cthulhu Font even assisting now. But again, those Wild Hunters are kind of making it awkward. Doesn't necessarily want to go all out on them.
Yeah, and the risky thing here is when Boxy leaves the top lane, he does actually leave, obviously, an open lane. So expect perhaps, you know, Tempest to rotate over and them to start pressuring the tier 1 bottom lane.
Yeah, bottom lane indeed, Swiftblade. He gets the spin off. He's going to be fine. And actually, nope, never mind. He's not going to be fine. The TP unsuccessful. The auto attacks, too much damage right there. And sure enough, Casey goes down. So well played right there. Coming out from Willicky, but yeah, all four heroes being down here, but hey, I guess it gets a kill there. Still managing to lock down that Swift Blade. That's what it comes down to here.
Yep, level 2 obviously now, only 78 GPM, but and this is what I was talking about, this is where the tier 1's tower's top starts getting pressured in, because Box has left the lane, but he's going to come back here to try and have some presence, but Tempest is already here, so expect this tier 1 tower most likely to fall unless Tree do start rotating some more players into the top lane.
Yeah. Just to clarify, it is the Winter Bracket Finals. I know when the overlay was messed up right there. I was saying the losing round 3 still, so I changed it right there, though, so we're going to go now. Again, this is the Winter Bracket Finals, sure enough. Shout out to chat for making that statement there, making me aware. Top lane, you got Tempest. He's got the minions here, looking to make the push. He's, of course, level 4 minions. As a result of being level 3, but Boxy on Cthulhu Font, he's quite a threat, even by himself, and we'll see if he can make something happen. Swiftblade, in the meantime, he's also coming with the flanks. Speaking of a lot of heroes being in the same spot, Sync kind of doing that now, as they got four heroes up here. And they're going to guarantee the tower kill. So 4 minute soul coming out from Pharaoh, just simply trying to push them back a little bit. But in the end, that is going to be a tower kill. Not much more than Willowkeeper could slash should have done there in the end. There is 1,400 plus gold, though, on Alonia. She's almost died, actually. So doing that jungle farm once again, taking some good life. But she is fine and finishes her steam boots as a result. Right there. So what about priority? I mean, I know you talked about the Staff of the Master being a good pickup, but does she go that first or something else first?
No, she normally goes like another farming item, either like Grimoire, but sometimes she does like to pick up kind of an item that's useful in terms of team fights, like the Sheep Stick. Okay. I mean, Balthazar, like, I've seen him go a lot of different things than the Alonia, so I honestly couldn't tell you what he's going to go for. In terms of what he needs now, though, in terms of the team fights, I think honestly he could use like something that sort of bulks him up a little bit, because he is quite squishy, and seeing as he's going against a Doctor of Repulsar, you know, Zinc do have the ability and the mobility to actually get, you know, to the back lines of Alonia and start, you know, dishing out and sort of bursting him down. So maybe something that would increase his sort of tankiness, even increase his mobility, perhaps like a 4-star for, you know, a tablet of commander, or even maybe an icon as well. But we'll have to see what he goes in the end. But, I mean, Nymphoria is level 6 now as well, so expect some rotations to come out from the Doctor Repulsar and Nymphora.
Now, I mean, I understand it, because if you go straight Portal Key, you're going to be, you know, lacking the mana as far as comboing if you're a Behemoth, but I am a little curious at the same time, especially with the start of this game. I know they're kind of trying to prioritize, but he actually chooses to finish full Steam Boots here, and that's 1,000 gold. That's, you know, I guess more so 950, but still gold that's setting him back from actually getting that portal key ASAP. I mean, I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying I'm kind of curious about the decision.
And yeah, I mean, I think it's warranted though. Like, I think he has to go Stumitz first, because like, if he goes straight portal key, then he's not even going to be able to use the portal key. Like, the portal key's like 75 mana, and then obviously all of his combo as well. Like, he doesn't have obviously Ring of Sorcery. Like, he's going to be completely mana starved if he doesn't pick up these steam boots. It also offers him some kind of lightning presence as well. Obviously, he was against the Swiftblade, so if he does need the extra sort of tankiness, it's going to be useful. Either like he goes straight red boots into Ring of Sorcery, then into Portal Key, or he goes straight Steam Boots into Portal Key, which I think in this case is pretty fair that he goes straight into Steam Boots and then Portal Key.
Well, looks like they might be pushing out this bottom lane. You see the Elementals down here, even Fissure Stun used to kind of clean it up. So, yeah, I think the push is coming. You got Torture, Alonia, and Behemoth all doing their thing. Level 9 Alonia, by the way. She is actually the highest level in the game up there with Meraxes. Also being level 9. Speaking of portal keys, his portal key is coming along nicely. 13 now, nearly 1,400 gold saved up, so expect that to be a huge factor. Yeah, he's farming. Okay, that was experience, but still, 360 gold per minute. He's up there at the top of the game currently at this point. Here comes that bottom push, though. Torment, it's only level 2, but still plenty of damage coming out from it. You see Alonia kind of leading the way with her farm currently. You know, perhaps the tankiest right now, but still needs to be a little careful. She gets jumped. Could be dangerous, so see Tempest doing all that he can, and they have Doctor and Nymphora nearby. Now, Doctor not the best on mana, but Nymphora, there's the Grace of the Nymph, has those Agility Steam Boots set, getting maximum mana as a result. So good teamwork coming out right there. And now he's definitely going to be good to go if a fight does happen. And that still could very likely happen if Willowkeeper keeps going. I think they are. So they're going to have to be really careful with this. Behemoth does have his ultimate, being that shot. This is going to be a close call. We're definitely going to see deny attempt at least. See Behemoth now. He can Fissure Stun in the background and kind of block them off if he really wants to. Oh, that's an Invis. I think he might have been in range there, though, for a second. There's the Fissure. It's so close, man. It's this tower.
I think Zinga
got
it. Yeah,
they got it. Okay. It's too much threat. Yeah, even Pharaoh was coming. It's all five.
I think they wanted to prioritize the portal key on Meraxes before their team fight, because like the worst case scenario is that, you know, they take a team fight, their Meraxes portal keys. Meraxes ports him, and then he dies, and he's like 1,700 gold, and he gets a delayed portal key. So just giving up a T1 isn't, you know, the worst decision here from Zinc.
Yeah.
Obviously, it allows Swiftblade to get even more farm in the top lane, which they have rotated him on, which he definitely did need, because obviously he was getting absolutely nothing. And it's fine, obviously, now they can rotate the Doctor and Repulsor and Nymphora to stop farming the jungle and give a lane to Swiftblade.
Yeah, he's kind of similar to what the Legion team did exactly with the Behemoth. Now, Swiftblade's been picking up a little bit of farm. I mean, only 183 gold per minute still, but it's, believe it or not, a lot better than what he was getting at the beginning of this game. But that goes back to, again, what Tree was attempting to accomplish. So that's what I'm talking about, though, for Willowkeeper. Very kind of just a lineup in general, very early game oriented. We're now approaching, 13 and a half, 14 minutes in here. So by now, you would start to expect that their power to start shining through. So I'm kind of curious, when that a portal key on Behemoth, sure, that'll definitely help as well. But at this rate, I mean, he's still a long ways away, honestly. Only 200 gold saved up. Currently, tablet is the choice for Alonia, by the way. Yeah. Using her gold there. And they're going to kind of group up middle lane, it looks like. So, again, they got some strong team fight. They're going to need it right here. Dr. Pulsar goes in. Can he shockwave at least? No, he can't. The lockdown's right. Can he get it off? Yo, he could not get it off in time. Get through the button in trouble as well as Torture. Attempt ultimate is going to be canceled, though, by Fair. Alonia now joining the party. She has absolute zero. She is going to use it right here. A lot of damage as a result. Morax is barely alive. He will fall in the end. So, Alonia showing off for damage right there as Kazu now comes in. You see Fair off to the side. He's looking for the angle, but he can't really get the best one. Torment is still in. And I believe Sync is now going to start retreating as they do. Alonia chasing with those glacial spikes, but not able to connect. If they don't connect, of course, no damage coming out. I know that's obvious, but hey, might as well say it. She's going to take some stuns from Tempest. Feral going back in, actually. They catch Dr. Pulsar, and Dr. will fall. Beautiful man up right there by Kraken, knowing that the teamwork was going to be in play. No buybacks needed. They just resurrect. And now they're going to be pushing this middle lane.
Yeah, 2-for-2. Great. And I mean, like, I think they had a good, obviously, start. They took down two instantly, but then they sort of stayed around, and they had very, very low mana, and they weren't in the greatest position to really team fight. Obviously, they had the numbers advantage, but if they had no mana to really use their spells, then they're a little bit worthless in that respect. Obviously, Meraxes did fall initially to the Lonia, so Tree did get a little bit something extra, picking off that Doctor Repulsor.
Yeah.
So, play from them.
More access as tanky as he is, especially with that Matrix up. You did see Alonia able to break through it again, Absolute Zero. She is level 11 now. I believe she only had the level 1 ultimate there even. So now having a level 2 Absolute Zero, that much more damage going to be coming out as a result of it. So good news there for Tree, definitely. I still feel like Behemoth, man. Obviously, he died right there, so that hurt, but he's still a long ways from that portal key. And until they get that, I'm still a little bit fearful for Tree's chances here as far as moving forward, but no doubt a good momentum kind of a fight there. And they're going to group up once again in the middle lane. So they are...
Tempest Ultimate down.
Is it? Yeah, that's true. It is down. So
that's what they're doing.
Last fight, Swift Slashes are also down for a little bit longer. They do have Matrix, though, and here we go. Speed of that. Marxist goes in on a Torture. Pharaoh in the background. He actually catches an M4 back there. I don't know if that's the target he wanted. Matrix is up. Torture actually survives. Not for long, says Dr. Bolster. But Alonia, the damage intense, man. Down goes Maraxis. Tablets over the ledge to get away from Swiftblade, and Dr. Pulsar, once again, he is in trouble. He's barely any mana on him. If he gets any bit of stun, he could be falling right here, but I think he's out of range. Yeah, the slows are not affecting. Nice stun on the Swiftblade there. They got through the Von Charge just to the right, though. Or the left, even. It actually does get away. So another back-and-forth battle there.
One.
But hey,
yeah,
Tree coming out on top.
Trade. Yeah, definitely a bad trade, and they're still going to push on, so they're going to try and take this tier 1, but they don't actually want to give this up too easily.
There. And they shouldn't. I mean, they feel like they have a good chance. Maraxis is going to be up in 10 seconds here. Swiftblade has those Swift Slashes. And it's not going to happen, though. Yeah, tower falls, and Tree ultimately gets what they came for there in the big picture. Another 2,000 gold saved up on Alonia. So he's really starting to jump up there now.
I mean, another thing that Bowser likes to do is go portal key as well. Increases mobility just to, like, similar to Thunderbringer, like, yeah, he's kind of like an intelligence nuker, and obviously you want to beef up and have increased mana pool and things like that, but if you can't get your spells off because of bad sort of positioning, then there's no point even having the spells in the first place. So having that extra portal key just increases mobility as well. So, and you might even go portal key as well. We'll have to see.
What about... I know we never see the items. I'm going to suggest two right here, though. Spell Sunder or Spell Shards, even. Is there any logic for those, or just better items?
The only reason is that if he goes that, then once I pick up Shrunken Heads, there's no way of dealing with it. Although Portal Key, yeah, obviously doesn't really help too much against Shrunken Heads, it offers a little bit more because obviously the positioning can help with the flash freeze in terms of stuns. He might go Sheepstick as well, and yeah, Spell Sunder and Spell Shards are great, but once I pick up Shrunken Heads, they're just completely worthless items in that respect. So particularly in competitive play, it's just quite risky to actually go for those items. But before Shrunken Heads, yeah, they'd be great items. They'd do a lot of damage, but I mean, Zinc definitely do know that the Shrunken Heads are going to be the most important pickups here in the coming future. So
You see right there, that's kind of interesting. Baltazar, they're 2-2 as a team, but Baltazar is 2-0 when he plays it in that more of that carry presence here. And I don't know if we've cast out of one of those games, because I feel like we haven't, because I feel like this is the first time we're actually seeing her on Honkast here as far as being a very farm-heavy focus hero. So very interesting, but yeah, Tree making a point that they like playing her, and Balchazar's hand has actually worked out so far for them. Again, 523 gold per minute overall is what she's ended up with, so the potential is there. Yeah, it's safe to say, when it comes to farming, I mean, she's very good at that with her skill set, of course. So top tower push, this is going to be a free tower kill, looks like. Zinc is not interested in defending it. They're still looking for their next bigger and better items, but one being Doctor's Icon of the Goddess, which I believe he just got enough for right there. He can split up the Ring of Sorcery here to pick it up if he wants to. Well, tower exchanging going on right there between the two teams. As Swiftblade, again, he's fairly squishy. He's got the Ghost Marchers and the Energizer here.
He's recovered really well.
Recovered, yeah.
And that's obviously because, help on the side of actually really did focus his farm. Obviously, he Swiftblade started farming the top lane, and then from there, obviously, I think Dr. Repulsor and Nymphora started taking ancients in the jungle, and did obviously give a free lane for Swiftblade. So, has recovered very, very well actually. So, just good play count from Zinc and Hull as a whole. Sorry.
Puzzlebox picked up by Pharaoh, as Icon is picked up by Dr. Repulsor. So, a couple of bigger item pickups there. Funny, it looks like she's going straight for the Sheepstick now.
For the Sheepstick. Yeah, it's going to be definitely needed, because once they have the Shrunken Heads, there's nothing they can deal with it, obviously. But with the Sheepstick, it does nullify quite a lot, obviously, the Shrunken Heads, because they can burst them down from full to nothing, regardless of the Shrunken Heads, if they have that Sheepstick.
That was
pretty
big.
Yeah, narrowly missed the top.
That top lane, I don't know if they may be hurt or something. The presence of mind, just they simply were running away as they TP'd in with Nymphora. So both Behemoth and Alonia are fine. and they go back to farming. How's that portal key coming along? Okay, he even got it. Jeez, he's still getting some more earlier stuff. The Mystic Vestments has the power supply, so we're just seeing not afraid to get more of the early game items, not necessarily rushing the portal key here. As Tempest, he is
going to
be
man.
Yeah, that was close.
Yeah, I'd actually really like to see Tree put in like an aggressive ward in the bottom lane here. Like, because if you think about it, like, Tempest always has to farm the enemy jungle. Firstly, because obviously it's going to restrict the farm from Tree, but at the same time, they've got Doctor Repulsor and Nufura farming their own jungle, as well as obviously giving Swiftblade a lane to farm. There's not much else where Tempest can farm, so going in the enemy jungle is kind of the best thing that he can do. And if they have like an aggressive lane ward here, they're going to spot the rotations from Tempest, and that's going to be an easy kill because he doesn't have a portal key. He does have a TP, but you know, one stun's going to instantly kill him, so I would like to see them put like a lane ward bottom. But I mean, if you see the enemy jungle, the Hellbound jungle, there's been a lot of aggressive wards here come out from Tree, actually. So they do have at least a vision of who's farming where, for example.
Middle lane, Pharaoh, Infis. Do they have any kind of vision? It doesn't look like it. He's going to Mobby Wall, trapped him right here. In come the TP. He's in a lot of trouble. Swiftblade, he has some slashes. Oh. He means he's using the cans. The trample hits. And down they both go. Nymphora and Swiftblade, Meraxes. He's going to TP out. He will be fine, but a two for nothing. Great initiation opening by Kraken right there on Pharaoh. And doing a lot of work to ultimately get those kills in the end. So,
yeah, room control, boys.
Exactly.
Control
big plays.
They're going to rotate bomb here. I don't know if they can take their tier 2 in time, though. The Wrath of Pharaoh obviously used. And obviously, she plays up in 19 seconds, so.
Oh,
they're going to be able to really. Yeah, all that elemental gold as well.
Ridiculous. That Alonia farm,
I mean,
man.
At this moment in time, obviously the Tree have hit their peak. It's the mid game. There's no Shroud heads picked up from Zynga Esports in that respect. So now is where you know Tree are the strongest, and this is where obviously Zynga want to sort of dodge fights as much as possible. That's why when Tree started pushing the tier 2 bottom, they tried to trade mid. Obviously, it was just good play out from Kraken there to obviously get the two kills in that respect. But obviously. You know, 10, 15 minutes down the line, Tree won't be as strong as they were. So
no.
Definitely something to be put in mind.
Well, that's what I want to get at, though. I mean, you look at some items coming out here on the Hellborn side. It looks like Swiftblade is going more of an aggressive build, going to the Firebrand. You know, so he's passing the Shrunkenhead option. Now, sure, he has the spin, of course, but you know that's not always going to be up and using it for that purpose necessarily. Dr. Repulsor, I gotta think he goes Shrunken here next, right? I mean.
Yeah.
There's no question.
I think it has to be, because, I mean, but at the same time, I mentioned it in the last Doctor's game, like, if he goes Shrunkenhead now, then he might have mana issues. Obviously, he does have the Nymphora there, but I definitely think Shrunkenhead is the way to go, because, I mean, like, you pick up Shrunkenheads, how are the Tree really going to do anything against you, as I mentioned before? Yeah. Obviously, Swiftblade does have his Blade Frenzy, so you can understand him not going Shrunkenhead, and Meraxes is going to go for Hellflower, which is understandable as well, because he has a lot of mana issues as well, so if he goes straight Portal Key into Shrunkenhead, he will have a lot of mana issues. Similar to sort of Doctor Repulsor, but and also the Hellflower is going to be useful in terms of sort of locking down the Alonia as well. So I don't sort of disagree with that in that respect. But I definitely think he'll go Shrunkenhead after the Hellflower. But for Doctor Repulsor, I think we might see Shrunkenhead next time.
Another good power of Nymphora showing right there. She actually TPs herself into the Legion jungle, places that ward of sight, and then Homecoming stones out. So. Good use of her teleport right there. Sure, it's a 70-second cooldown at this point, or 90 seconds, excuse me, cooldown at this point, but definitely well worth it. Getting some good vision right there. Behemoth is getting very close now to that portal key. So after all the talk earlier on, I mean, it's 24 minutes in, so it's definitely later than you would like probably in the end, but hey, you know, they've been winning some fights without it. Just imagine now when they get it, how much better of a chance that'll give them here going
Cheap
into
stigma.
The fights. Was that a Wrath of the Pharaoh that missed?
Oh.
Or no, he actually is over here. He's doing some work against Swiftblade. Okay, for some reason, I thought he was somewhere else.
Sheepstick picked up now as well for
yep.
Alonia. So they have ways to really deal with it. I mean, with this Sheepstick pickup, I would actually love to see him go Portal Key because, yeah, Tablet is fine and all, but like, if they want to get the burst down on someone before they pop the Shrunken Heads, he'll need a Portal Key to really utilize the Sheepstick. That's why we normally see Sheepstick always picked up from like mid-initiates, because once they blink in, they can stun or do their initiation, and then Sheepstick straight after to really stagger that lockdown. But for Alonia as your carry, it's like, yeah, you want to be in the back to really sort of use your nukes, but at the same time, then how are you going to really use your Sheepstick? So, top lane, though.
No, Doctor's low on mana. Yeah, he couldn't go too far right there. This is going to be a successful kill as a result. Out comes that Sheepstick, and Flensmeister is going to end up falling. Now, his teammates are counter-pushing the bottom lane. But, yeah, with him dead, that's going to hurt. We'll see. Now, they did TP up there, and obviously Sync's aware of that. So, they know this should be a free tower kill.
They got the tower top as well, actually.
Did they?
They didn't deny it.
They did. So, actually, you know, even with the kill on Plensmeister, not as good as you may expect in the end. I mean, sure, a kill's nice, but they do lose ultimately two towers going for the kill. So, that's where it's really unfortunate that it didn't work out as planned in that sense. But
and this is sometimes the almost awkwardness of, obviously, with Tree's lineup. When they don't pick a jungler, it's really hard for them to really have any kind of pushing presence, whereas like almost every jungler in the game upon has some kind of pushing potential, obviously, with Tempest, Keeper, Ophelia, even Parasite, obviously, when we saw in the last game, obviously, with the Hell Cannon picked up. So, like, obviously, with the secondary support Behemoth, like, they've got no pushing potential. The only way they can push towers is if they get a team fight, like a team fight wipe. And, obviously, we're not seeing that here. Like, Zinc, well, they don't even have to get a team fight to start pushing, because obviously they got the Tempest, so something to obviously be mentioned. But here comes Tree. They are rotating into the enemy jungle, but
and again, you gotta think that they're very aware too. That they know that they've been, you know, winning some fights here and there. They've been getting some kills. They have the kill lead 7-4, but this is not a game that they can afford to drag on much longer. Even it's because of just how their lineup is built. Once the Shark and Ed start kicking in, I think Doctor's almost there. I believe he has two components. He just needs the pattern, I believe. And then he'll have it, or maybe not, but still, he's working on it, at least, it's safe to say. Tempest going for himself. He has to play with the Firebrand, but of course he has a spin for Magic Community. So, yeah, Tree knows that they got to keep some pressure on here. And they're going to do just that here in the middle lane as they get the tower kill.
I guess they have Impalement, actually, with that push.
But yeah, well, that's
probably true. Not as strong as Tempest, but yeah, you know what I mean.
Still is good. Torture is fairly squishy, especially as that main support, but yeah, she gets in range.
And
the
puzzle box, actually. They got puzzle box as well.
They do?
Still.
Yeah. Is this level 3 yet? Those are level
1, 2.
Yeah, I didn't think they were level 3, so. They're going to actually do some good damage to the tower right here. You do see Rex's playing back.
Why would you put a water site when puzzle box minions are
up? Oh, yeah. Here we go, Doctor. They're jumping. Alonia right here. The response will be powerful enough. She gets out away with the tablet. She ran right into Morax's cell. She gets the absolute zero off. She falls shortly after, but minimal damage from Alonia. As a result, that might do it for St. Kate's Force. They clean up Cthulhuvan, or excuse me, Behemoth. Cthulhuvan is still alive here, as tanky as he is, but not going to be enough. Nobody dies, or I guess Morax's may have died, but still. A 4-for-1 exchange in favor of Sync Esports, and all because the initiation onto Alonia, they could not keep her alive in the end.
Yeah. Kill Alonia, win team fight, but simply, like, they've, what Tree have drafted here, they've got kind of like heavy and tanky cores, obviously, with like Behemoth, Pharah, and Philippine, to really sort of be the durable frontliners here for Tree. And then obviously you've got Alonia in the background, sort of just completely just doing so much damage, doing so much nuke damage. But I mean, I stated before, Zinc, they have the ability to really go through the tanky liners here of Tree. They've obviously got the portal key on Maracas, but also the Doctor of Pulsar as well. So they've got ways of really going and getting back to the Alonia, the sort of the back liner. And once you kill Alonia, then the damage here for Tree is just not sustained. They don't really have ways of, you know, winning these team fights, as we saw there. Obviously, Strong has picked up now from Dr. Repulsor as well, and so there is that portal key, though, and this is what I'm saying. He needs that kind of mobility to make sure he doesn't get picked off. If as long as he can get his spells off and without getting locked down, then obviously he should be fine. But
how about this, too? Token of life they give to Moraxis, actually.
He has been dying in every single team fight, actually. It's really strange, obviously. He's like normally a very tanky mid initiator, but he like, almost every single team fight, except the last one, he has died. Tempest is dead.
Yeah, he's going to get caught. I know he has a shrunken head, but of course, really no time to use it. And at that point, it would have been worthless anyway. So, good find from Willowkeeper. That's definitely what they're going to need here. As it progresses, he doesn't have a buyback either. And I want to say they probably know that too, because he just got that shrunken head. So, yeah, they're going to really try to make a statement here of pushing into the base. And this is interesting from Sync, because I don't know if they want to defend, honestly, without Tempest. I mean, sure, they'll do a little bit of poking.
They can't give
here,
up Rex, though.
Yeah, they can't give up Rex, so that's where it's difficult. But it is going to be a 5 versus 4, so that pick on his left might be a lot bigger than we realized initially. Torturer, he's in the front lines. He's basically saying, you know, come at me. I'm a support. I don't really care. And that's what Swiftblade's going to do, but he'll be fine in the end as he spins away. Not overstepping his boundaries. Nice stun attempt right there, but unsuccessful. And they are going to finish off the tower. Denied, not really the biggest deal, though, in the end. So Tempest is going to resurrect here. In fact, Moraxis wants to make a fight happen now. He's going in with those axes. Matrix popped. He misses the stun. The slow is being heavily applied, though, to Cthulhuvan. And I think Cthulhuvan's going to be fine in the end. Pharah with the mummy walls. They don't want to overcommit, though. Alonia in a pretty good spot for a flank. There's another stun miss for Moraxis. He can't land those stuns, man. It's not the... I mean, you got to be right next to them, clearly. And not able to do so. But Tree does not want to risk anything. They actually ultimately all fall back, even despite the poor initiation there.
Yeah, I mean, they're fine against Token, though, so it's very, very risky. Like, the Stronghold Head's now picked up a Doctrine, Tempest. That's a risky decision, but at the same time, I mean, what are they delaying for? It's only going to get worse, I guess. Yeah. Middle lane, though.
Go for Pharaoh. I don't know if it's going to be a kill, though, in fact. Yeah, it gets away. No, he is out of mana once again. Wrath of the Pharaoh, he has it. But no, he's going to be locked down, and down goes Pharaoh. Well played. Alonia does get in here, but there goes the Shrunken Head, and all of a sudden, their turn is real. Cthulhu also falls, and yeah, the supporting caches couldn't get there in time. So that was also pretty good bait, though, from Sync, to be fair. I think that was the intention all along, so well played on their part. And you know, they hit that wall. It's like you knew it was coming. For yep. Willowkeeper, you knew it was coming. The Shrunken Heads were going to start appearing, and it's just they just lose all sorts of damage as a result.
Yeah, and I mean, they had like a time where they're incredibly strong. They hit their timing at sort of the 20-minute mark, but once they hit that timing, like Zinc just played it incredibly well. Split push as much as possible, try to delay as much as possible until Shrunken Heads in the middle lane to go back in.
This is not good. If Polonia falls right here, that could officially do it. I mean, okay, she doesn't have a buyback if anything, but yeah, she goes down. This is going to at least be the secondary tower push. Now, they did use one Shrunken Head on Tempest. But again, they have the token on Meraxes here. I don't see why they don't just keep going here. If anything, force the buyback onto Alonia. Sync is just sure, they could fall back and play it safe, but why not at least force it if you can? And that's exactly what they're going to do here now. Behemoth, I was going to say, he's level 11. He goes in right there with the shockwave. He gets done with the follow-up, though. He can't even get the fissure off. Dr. Repulsor will finally fall. As he does get the fish off, Alonia fires back and now joining the party as well. And Nymphoric going for the TP. She should be successful. Yes, she will. As all the chain reactions. Just a little late. Swiftblade, nice spin right there. He also has a Shrunken that he just got.
Yeah, Shrunken Heads were down on Doctor and Tempest as well. So that's why the team fight was okay for Tree, I guess. But still Token now on Meraxes. And I mean, Tree, it's almost like they're all in at this moment. They're like, Doctor's down, we just got to try and do something, because they've missed their timing. And once they had the timing at sort of the 20-minute mark, they just really didn't get too much, really. They didn't trade too much, and they didn't really take advantage of the timing they had. And as a result, now it's looking a little bit bad for him. And Doctor's going to be up the next team fight as well, so they're not going to be able to sort of trade much either for that. So.
And I will say this, I mean, I know damage shards can be a little bit, you know, it shouldn't take it for 100% of face value, but Alonia's damage not being up there, I mean, it's up there with the rest of them other than Pharaoh. Pharaoh's just crazy up there, that's what he does though, throwing soul spam and everything. But honestly, I would expect Alonia to be higher, and that's, I think, what the Willowkeeper would have needed for them to be successful, because that's what it's all about. It's about building her up initially. And again, as you said, they accomplished at least that part, but the follow-up just wasn't there. And you know, looking at those damage charts kind of gives you an idea more so that it just wasn't there for them. They weren't able to execute necessarily. So, again, obviously they're still remaining in this game. Figuring out, hey, if they get lucky, win a fight, get a couple of pickoffs here or there, then definitely that'll open the door a little bit. But you got to think they're similar to our line of thinking here, that their chances are looking pretty grim as this game continues to progress on, just simply because of the lineup here. So,
I mean, obviously they have ways to sort of deal the Shrunken Heads with like the Sheep Tick on Alonia, but the only problem is three Shrunken Heads being picked up from Zinc, and they don't obviously have three Sheep Sticks, so they can't really counter out every single the Shrunken Head from Zinc. And like, yeah, it's just, I don't know, it just seems strange, like how Tree, they drafted this lineup and yet they didn't almost try and force it that they had that timing. I guess it's obviously hard to sort of go high ground when you don't have the pushing potential, but yeah. I guess it just goes back to drafting in that respect. But
yeah, absolutely. And you know, hey, Balthazar was 2-0 on Alonia coming into this game, but when you're facing a top dog like Zinky, of course you might as well throw stats like that out the window, because they're obviously a completely different team than really, honestly, any team out there at this point. So I know, sure, they're coming off a lost cycle last cycle, but just as far as overall consistency of what they do, BMG is still the only team to actually defeat them in a series. Here we are now in cycle number 5, so. Well, I didn't mean like that, Quincy. We still love you here, of course. But just kidding. They're going to try to push the top tower here. This is, I guess, the bottom secondary is still up below half-life. But again, kind of the older movement here from Tree. They know that they're in that gap and doing what they can, but Sync continues to do a great job of split pushing. In fact, they're going to TP back. Yeah, they're TPing actually in an interesting spot here, kind of in a flank position. And Doctor says, here we go, baby. Alonia gonna be the target once again. Behemoth with that stun. Shrunken Heads, of course, causing issues. And look at, I mean, Alonia just can't do anything. And neither could the team to support. You just know after that fight, I gotta think Tree's like, all right, yeah, well, what's the point?
And honestly, like, I mean, I mentioned it a little bit before, because obviously, but the Doctor Repulsor, just having the ability to instantly jump on Alonia is just too strong. Like, normally you can have Pharaoh, Cthulhu, and Behemoth all sort of protecting Alonia in terms of if, you know, the enemy team tries to sort of run and get to Alonia, but with Doctor Repulsor, like, he can fly across halfway across the map and just get to Alonia, and once that's, you know, once Alonia's been jumped on, then there's nothing they can do. Spell Shards is picked up by Behemoth, though. So...
Interesting.
Yes.
Speaking of that,
Spell Shards is actually a little bit better on Behemoth than it is on Alonia, because Alonia, her damage is going to be sort of continued, so against Shrunken Heads it's not going to be that useful, but for the Spell Shards on the Behemoth it's going to be instant, so it's not going to really be nullified by Shrunken Heads, because if you can get the initiation off, then obviously the magic damage is going to be happening, whereas Alonia Spell Shards, she's going to be fighting against Shrunken Heads, because obviously she won't have the jump in that respect compared to Behemoth. So.
Yeah, no, I think there is definitely a lot more value to it on the Behemoth, as you're stating, but it is still always one of those interesting items. Very, very, very few times we do see it. But, you know, maybe it also has a lot to do with, especially with a fight coming out, just be like, you know, get something here. At least it's going to help.
Yeah.
With the fight coming up. And, you know, did just that. Obviously, no fight ended up happening, at least initially, because Sync, once again, playing more of the safer route here. This is just the first game of EPS at a 3 and want to secure the game one, as they know definitely that the only way Tree is going to win this is if throws happen on the part of Sync Esports, and hey, it could happen. Even the best of them have had their moments every now and then. So, but it's very unlikely for obvious reasons. So, Willow Keeper doing a lot of sticking together here, seeing if they can find anything. Well, they find some elementals, so a little bit of farm there for them, but obviously not the biggest deal. And yeah, I mean, look at Lonia's farm too. It's the items that she has. She's literally been sitting on those same items now for a good, I want to say, like 15 minutes almost.
She sold
like
the tablet as well, by the way.
She did sell the tablet, yeah. She also changed sold the Grave Locket earlier, didn't she? She had that too, so.
So she switched up the tablet for the portal key.
Yeah.
Which is a little bit like, well, why didn't you have portal key in the first place? But, I don't know.
Yeah, that seems like a very inefficient use of gold right there. Mm-hmm. In both of those cases. But, what's done is done. You see, again, a little bit of split pushing now coming out from Tree, and this is where it gets dangerous for them. If they're found out by themselves, and those are pretty much free kills for Sync Esports, especially with that Doctor, who, by the way, has 10 charges now on the Icon of the Goddess. He also has a regen room bottled up here. I'm going to say he's low on mana, but actually, he'll possibly pop it here in the near future and be just fine on mana. That's because regen OP and Doctor Repulsor. Somebody getting caught over here. Who is it? It looks like it is Pharaoh getting caught out initially. You got damage from Araxes and Swiftblade as well as Nymphora. And the lockdown on top of that damage proving to be way too much. Trample in focus on the bottom. Here we go. Absolute Zero Sheath took on Swiftblade. Swiftblade is going to fall. Maybe Jabba's on the comes out. Swiftblade does go down, but the hole comes out from Slap right there. And you see the Legion team melting as expected. Cthulhu does remain alive. That aura definitely coming into play right there. A lot of fear effects coming out. So at least he stays alive and will portal key away. But again, damage done by Sync Esports. And Swiftblade, by the way, he buys back immediately and now is running back in. They're going to go for Kongor, as they should. No reason not to here. The final buyback on to Balthazar coming out too, playing the Alonia here. So.
Yeah, but again, though, just the Shrunken Heads from Sync is just too strong. Obviously, that Tempestor slap was massive as well. But even without that, they would have won the teamfight, so... Yeah, Tree looking the close to the point of no return at the moment. Obviously, tokens will be most likely given to Doctor this time because has the more abilities to really use it or, you know, utilize it a little bit better than Miraculous this time. And Shrunken Head being picked up from Miraculous now as well. So, yep. Four Shrunken Heads.
As innovative and as diverse and as unique and even fun to an extent was seeing the strategy from Willow Gaper. This is why you don't see a strategy like they're running.
I mean, yeah, true,
four Shrunken Heads now on the Hellborn side. It's like, what do you do with that? Pharaoh goes in. He's like, okay, last resort. Let's make this happen. It ain't going to happen. Trying to pop a Roachit up in here, but nope, not going to happen. Alonia gets caught too. He will fall. And I expect to see the GGs coming out. Hat trick coming out for Zlapta, actually. Not your everyday hero to get hat tricks with on Tempest. But, oh, look at that. Yeah, making a point. Crack actually got the kill. Onto Kongor. So hey, there's a chance. There's a chance for Willow Keeper. They get the gold credit, not the token.
Man, that 30,000 experience yet. They're only down by 8 kills.
Yeah. There you go. GG, well played. Game 1 will go to Sync Esports here over Willow Keeper, so congratulations. But, I mean, really, is there much else to say other than, again, the idea was there. It could have worked, but they hit the wall, and
I mean,
it didn't.
The problem is, though, is that, like, Shrunken Heads are just so strong because you can pick it up so early and then it just sort of completely nullifies the sort of magic nuker sort of draft here from Tree. So, yep, nice idea, but this is the reason why we don't see it. Like, Grimoire is the first sort of item or the first sort of time where you started to see more intelligent sort of style of carries, but after that got nerfed as well, then this is the reason why we barely see a lot of intelligent sort of nuker carries or at all in the game. We never see Defiler. Because melee late game is just too strong, apparently.
Yeah.
In the meta. Unfortunately, because I want to see Defiler carry, man, but I don't think we will.
See Blacksmith carry. That's something we'll see, I'm sure.
I was playing Defiler today, man, but it doesn't have the same. It doesn't have the same feel to it as like a Swiftblade hard carry.
No, man. It doesn't. That's
unfortunately not.
No, you don't press R and win games as easily. Yeah, no. Obviously, Sync Esports again.